Hello, my name is EeveeDream, and this is a video guide on the Coliseum on flight rising. This is an introductory video more than anything else, and will help you to understand the basics of the battle system, what exalting is, and the bare minimum that you would need to get started in leveling your own fodder. Most of this information is from my own knowledge, but I consulted up to 16 different guides to ensure that I had a larger source of information than my own brain. As such, you will occasionally hear me refer to a guide. This is because I got that term or information from that guide. Some terminology. The terminology of the guide follows basic terminology used throughout FR when referring to the Coliseum. It may vary here and there, but here are the basic terms. Coli, which is short for Coliseum. I will be using the word Coli interchangeably with Coliseum throughout this guide. A venue is a section within the Coliseum. Mobs are the enemies that you face off against. Builds are the different stats and zones that determine what the dragon can do. Fodder are dragons whose sole purpose is to be exalted. Stoned refers to the fact that the dragon has proper battle stones. Statted refers to the fact that the dragon has the properly allocated stats for whatever build that they are. Alright, first things first. What is the Coliseum and why is it important? The Coliseum is a part of Flight Rising where you're able to battle mobs for loot, and to gain levels on dragons. You're able to face off against other players in the PvP section, but no one really battles there, as you can see from the one player on the versus leaderboard. You would have a better chance of getting a match with another player if you announce it on the forums than if you just jumped into it. As you can see, I'm not getting a battle. Battling in the Coliseum against enemy mobs is called grinding. It is considered tedious and boring to many, and therapeutic to a few. Many people find that watching shows, movies, or listening to podcasts or audiobooks help make it easier. Whatever the case, you'll be wise to find something to watch or listen to while you grind, so you don't get burned out. The Coliseum is divided into several areas called venues. Each venue has a different level, just the way dragons have different levels. The levels determine the minimum level of the dragon that will be required to battle there without getting easily defeated. What does this mean? Well, if I were to take these three right here and bring them to a venue like the Boreal Wood, they would not be fast enough nor strong enough to actually defeat their opponents. However, when it comes to leveling fodder, you can actually ignore this. The reason why is because the level 25 dragon that you're going to be bringing with the fodder is strong enough to withstand the opponents in the higher venue. However, this is only if you have them properly statted and stoned to the required battle build. These two girls here are a variation of the glass cannon build. They have slightly higher speed than other glass cannons, and they have slightly lower attack. However, because there are two of them, they're able to make up for it in the extra turns that they provide for each other. By defeating offensive mobs, that is, mobs that will bite or scratch immediately, they're able to avoid getting damaged right away. This is an example of leveling one fodder in the kelp beds with these two dragons. It doesn't take that long. In order to get to level 6, it really only takes about 5 minutes with these two dragons. The basic controls of the Coliseum, as you probably heard, if you could hear my mouse, is clicking. Clicking and holding a dragon in the team choosing, organized party page, allows you to click and drag dragons into the party slots. The dragon on the left goes first, if they're fast enough. Dragon in the middle goes second, dragon on the right goes third. What do I mean if they're fast enough? Well, Dusk and Blanco have higher quick than Nova, which means they would go before Nova even though he is first in line. It is recommended that the dragon in the first slot be either a fodder or any other dragon that is equal to the two here. If you're using a mage, it is recommended that you put your mage in the first slot and that the mage has at least one ambush stone to allow your physical attackers to have all of their turns. Alrighty, let's talk about the venues. Oops, gotta have at least a dragon here. That's another thing that I want to mention. You cannot access any other parts of the Coliseum unless you have a dragon in the party. If you don't have a dragon in the party, you cannot click on any of these. The Coliseum is divided into 16 venues of various levels, from 1 to 25. The higher level venues, from the arena down to the Golem Workshop, all have a boss in them. Those enemies have far more health and speed than regular opponents, and familiar drops from them are much rarer than that of other mobs. Every time you level your dragons, you get stat points. The stat points are assigned to each of the various stats in order to give your dragon higher strength, higher quickness, or higher intellect. Once a stat has been confirmed on a dragon, you cannot change it unless you have a tincture of dissolution. If you click on the dragon here, it's an invisible box about this big right here, like that, but it's not that low. An invisible box about here, you'll see the symbol for using the tincture of dissolution. You have to have it available in your horde in order to click this. As you can see, I do not have one. It resets the dragon stats down to 5, including breed bonuses. Every dragon breed has a certain number of bonuses. Tinctures of Dissolution are recommended only for dragons that you're leveling either to 17 or 25 or etc. etc. Basically, any dragon that's not fodder that you are leveling, it's recommended that you use a tincture of dissolution in order to have the properly allocated stats. Battle stones are objects that you give your dragon in order for them to have various offensive and defensive capabilities. There are 4 types of battle stones: energy stones, ability stones, augment stones, and accessory stones. As you can see, Blanco doesn't have any accessory stones, but Dusk has one called a field manual. The field manual gives its wearer insight to the battle readiness of all opponents, which, in short, grants vision of enemy ability / breath bars. So whenever you see an opponent use meditate, you're able to see how much breath they actually have. Energy stones build up energy called breath, used by both dragons and mobs alike in order to perform more powerful moves, such as eliminate and aid. Scratch is the most common of these energy stones. However, it is not the only one. Ability stones are more powerful than energy stones in terms of offensive, defensive, and healing capabilities. They often require breath to use, but some can give your dragons breath when you use them. Rally is one such stone that grants breath when it's used. Aid, Regenerate, and Sap are examples of healing-type ability stones. Let me give you an example of my... Here we go. Serenity is a type of dragon called a mage. Instead of having her stats in strength, she has them in intelligence. And she has higher quickness than many others. Her main stone is called Aid, which grants the target. While it says a small amount of health here, because most glass cannons, I will talk about them later, have low health, it actually grants them quite a bit of health. Rally and Concentration are examples of ability stones that grant breath while also giving you a stat buff. A buff is an increase in stats. Rally increases strength by 30 points. Concentration increases intelligence by 30 points. Contuse is a very interesting ability stone. It is a type of attack, and I'll get to those later. But what Contuse does is that while it deals damage, it gives a debuff of 25% of the strength of an opponent. While Meditate would grant a 75% debuff on strength for the user, Contuse is for the enemy. Augment stones are very passive stones. There are two types of passive stones, augment and accessory. The augment stones grant stats. It varies depending on the stone that you use, but for the most part, Scholar and Berserk are the ones used for Coliseum battlers. As you can see here, she has three Berserker stones. Berserker stones grant 5 health, 3 quickness, and 1 agility. The green on her stats shows which stats were increased by the augment stones. The same thing happens to Serenity, except she has 5 extra points per stone for a total of 15 in her intelligence stat. She also has 3 in her agility and 9 in her quickness. Ambush. Accessory stones, Ambush, Discipline, and what's that other one? Accessory stones are passive stones that you equip to your dragons. The most popular of the few accessory stones are Ambush and Discipline. However, Field Manual is another one. We spoke about that one before. Ambush grants the dragon an extra turn per stone. There is a glitch, however, that cancels out the first stone of the first dragon in your party. Remember, the first dragon is the one on the left. However, if the dragon on the left does not have an ambush stone, the next dragon in turn will lose their extra turn because they are the first one with an ambush stone. Most people counter this by putting a mage with 1 ambush stone in the front of the party. This allows the 2 battlers to have their full turns, while the mage will fall in line after them. Let's talk a bit more about attacks. There are various attacks your dragons can use in the Coli, the most basic of which is Scratch, which we discussed before. However, it is not the only option you have unless you are just starting out in battle. Elemental attacks, which are ability stones, are nice to have if you want to be able to deal extra damage to mobs who are weak to that element. Blanco here has the Rune Slash ability stone, which is an arcane-based attack. Each element is usable only by dragons of that flight. For example, nature attacks are only usable by nature dragons. If I had a nature-based attack, I wouldn't be able to put it on Blanco. As you can see here, this is an earth attack, and it's only usable by earth dragons. Blazing Slash is only usable by fire dragons, etc., etc. Let's talk a bit more about builds. There are a lot of different builds to use in the Coliseum. A lot. A lot of these builds, however, are variations of each other. Mainly a variation of something called a glass cannon. A glass cannon is a dragon with high strength, high quickness, and low vitality. This girl here is a variation. The basic stats for a glass cannon are these: 129 strength, 13 vitality, and 50 quickness. These stats are based off of one particular guide. I'm sure many of you have seen this. How to Train Your Dragon by Duke, aka Colix's guide. This guide is a step-by-step guide in how to level your own dragons. It's very, very handy if you have no idea how and when to up the stats. It shows it for both tinctured and untinctured. Let's see. As you can see, it goes all the way up to the Kelp Beds, but it also hits the Golem Workshop. The Golem Workshop, as it says here, is a very tough zone. It's higher in strength than the Kelp Beds despite being the same level. It's very handy to have a mage in the Golem Workshop. Moving on, there are also Ruin Meditate Monks, which are exact same as Ghostbusters, with one variation. They have a Meditate Stone. Why would they have a Meditate Stone? Meditate, as we discussed before, gives a strength debuff for 3 turns. Well, it turns out that even though Meditate applies a strength debuff for 3 turns after casting it, it takes 4 turns for a Ruin Meditate Monk, to actually set up for an Eliminate. Basically, this means that even though they would have a strength debuff for 3 turns, they'll only be using their Eliminate on their 4th, or 5th, depending on how you battle. So really, the debuff doesn't really mean anything. Serenity, being a mage, I have mentioned her several times before, is mainly used as support. She heals, reduces damage from opponents, and gives buffs, both in strength and intelligence. However, the intelligence is mainly for her. The strength is for the other dragons that she fights alongside. Trainer dragons, well, trainers, it's a very, very broad term. You can say Coral is a trainer. Serenity could also be a trainer as well. Varelfinol and Tagi. This is Tagi. Are trainers. When I say trainers, I'm referring to teams of 2. Teams of 2 dragons that are able to level a single fodder dragon in the Kelp Beds. Trainers have one major variance in terms of other dragons, and that is the Reflect Stone. Because they are battling in the Kelp Beds, which has magic-based enemies, well, magic-based bosses, I should say, the Reflect Stone is extremely essential. It requires 40 breath in order to cast. However, once it is cast, it reflects all magical abilities, even if it's cast by your own teammate. Now, it doesn't matter what element your 2 trainers are, because there are 2 dragons. Once you're actually set up with enough breath, you're hardly going to get hit by any type of elemental attack. I have 2 trainer dragons, that are both lightning types, which is not recommended for the kelp beds. However, because it's two of them, it doesn't really matter. They don't usually get hit. This is an example of the dragon scratch eliminating everything in the kelp beds. They are strong enough to do this because they have a high enough strength stat. Corrosive Depends and Depends, however, no matter how high the strength stat is, unless of course you're using shattered cannons, they have to be scratch eliminated. And don't worry about your dragon fainting. As long as you win the battle, they're going to come back with some health. Kelp tenders and mammoths also have to be scratch eliminated, even if your dragon is rallied on a standard glass cannon build. I'm going a little bit slower than normal, but I estimated and actually timed myself leveling my dragons. Fodder dragons can be leveled up to level 6 in about 5 minutes. Now, I'm going to show you how to use Rally and show you how a rallied eliminate on a standard glass cannon can one-shot enemies in the kelp beds. By giving 30 extra stat points, she's able to make quick work of the opponents. So having Rally can be very useful. And here's the Wave Sweeper. This is a boss. Wave Sweepers deal magical damage. Now, I do not recommend using the Reflex right away. It gives you more time to actually have them on and build up more breath to build up a second shield, because the Reflex will not last the entirety of the battle. So here we go with the last two turns that these girls have. I'm going to throw Reflect up on her, and I'm going to have her cast Reflect on herself as well. Here's the thing. Each dragon can only cast Reflect on themselves. That means that if Tagi casted Reflect on herself, then tried to cast Reflect on another dragon, it would actually leave her and go to the next dragon. So if you're going into the kelp beds with two dragons in order to face off against the Wave Sweepers, against the Manta Runes, and get this guy up to level 6, 7, or even up to 10, it's recommended that they both have Reflect. That way, they can be protected from damage from the bosses. As you can see, the Wave Sweeper used Meditate. That means that he has at least 30 points of breath. It's also not a physical attacker, so the Meditate exhaustion doesn't harm it. However, if one of these girls were to use it, they would be dealing 75% less damage in each of their scratches. Now, you'll see in a lot of guides that once you reach a boss, to just throw out all of your eliminates that you have breath for. However, I do not at all recommend this. When you are faced off against a boss and you throw up your reflect, save your breath. I'm serious. Save your breath. That way you'll be able to cast up a second Reflect when the first one runs out. If you waste all of your breath using Eliminate on the bosses, then you won't have enough to actually cast a second Reflect once it wears off, and then the boss will be able to actually attack you. Alright, so here we're going to Rally, and we're going to make quick work of the Marin Scouts on the sides. Even with a rallied eliminate, I always attack the physical hitters first. That way, even if one of them misses, I don't have any damage coming to me from the physical hitters. So if even if she survives, these two won't. At least to the best of my ability. I'm going to do one more battle and then going to go back to the dragons and point some stuff out. And then I'm going to go over a little bit of exhaustion. Alrighty. This guy is level 6. I usually level up to level 6 and then exalt because it's faster. And even though the profit is smaller, it really doesn't matter to me. What is exalting? Exalt as a word has a few meanings, but they all run along the same vein. The meaning that Flight Rising uses in regards to dragons is this: to raise to a higher rank or a position of greater power. A dragon that has been exalted is essentially removed from the game. They are sent off to live with the deity that their lair is under. The Arcanist, if it's an arcane-based lair, which I am, or Plague Mama, if it's a plague-based lair, Drool Mama, if it's a shadow lair, etc., etc. When they are sent off, they leave behind some treasure for the clan that they left. The amount of treasure left behind is dependent on the level the dragon is. The higher the level, the more treasure is left behind. Many players, myself included, take advantage of this reward by buying cheap dragons and leveling them so that when they are exalted, they get more treasure, than they spent on the dragon. Dragons that are bought and sold for this one purpose are called exalt fodder, or just fodder, like I mentioned in the terminology. Leveling fodder dragons is a quick and easy way to make money in the Coli. You don't have to wait until you have a certain number of drops to get a certain amount of money, and it's faster than maxing out the fairgrounds. Which is this. Before I got level 25 dragons, I had to max out the fairgrounds every single day. Well, almost every day because I'm a little lazy, and it's very tedious. In order to get 75,000 every day, it was my main source of money. The basics of fodder leveling is this. You have one or two trainers, like I mentioned before, that level one or two fodder dragons to any level between 6 and 10, and then you exalt the dragons. I showed an example a couple of moments ago. The more detailed version of fodder leveling is this. You have two trainers. If you have two trainers, you have one fodder, and all three are in the mire or the kelp beds. We were in the kelp beds with two trainers, remember? If you don't remember what they were, it was these two girls right here. If you have one dragon, you will have either a Mire Flyer or a Ghostbuster, or any variation of those two for different venues. And alongside that single dragon, you will have two fodder dragons. As you can see, I have several dragons here that I am preparing to level. This guy's already leveled. These two I will be leveling in the mire. I will show you an example at the end of this video. Now, when you have only one dragon, it's very important that you use either a build like this, which I mentioned earlier before, or a build like this. Because if you only have one dragon, but you need to level yours, it's possible. They just need to have the right stats. Alrighty. Let's go exalt this one dragon. And let me show you the treasure payout. The treasure payout. That last word didn't come out too clearly. Alright, I bought Harwin, he was already named, for 7,000 treasure. Let's see what I get for exalting him at level 6. He's going to the Arcanist, because I am an arcane lair. Look at that. It's about 4,000 extra treasure. It's not a massive profit, and if I would have leveled him to about level 8 or 9, I would have had a lot more. But it works for me. This guy is at level 7, a very common level that people level their dragons to. Let's see how much he gives me. He actually gave me less. It's a little bit weird. Well, actually, not really. You see, the amount of treasure given out at Exhaustion is actually random within a certain range. The higher range of the level 6 level Exhaustion is in the 11,000s. The lower range of the level 7 Exhaustions is actually in the mid-9,000s. Interesting, right? It goes without saying that the higher you level your fodder, the more profit you're going to make. Let me show you what it's like to level 2 fodder in the Mire. Here's Mary. I usually put her in the second slot or in the third slot. It's simply out of preference, however, you should never put them in the first slot because then they will lose a turn from their ambush glitch. Here's the 2 fodder. And here's the Mire. Now, this is one of the more ideal setups to start with. When you're heading into the Mire, or any other venue with a single leveler, it is important, it is very, very important to start out with mostly meditate enemies. Physical hitters like this poisonous Toradei will deal a lot of damage to your single dragon, and your dragon will not be able to defend itself for 3 whole turns. This means they will get 3 times the amount of damage, maximum, if the enemies do not crit hit, do not give a critical hit, and they will only be able to deal 1 turn of damage. Now, if you use Rally on your dragons, they'll be able to deal 2 turns of damage every time they get the chance to attack. Mary does not have a rally, so she has to endure the hits. However, once she's set up with enough breath, she's able to dish them out pretty hard. As you can see, we got 1,302 points of experience right off the bat. However, no victory chain experience. Very odd. Is it? Not entirely. You see, victory chains are bonus experience given to dragons depending on the venue that they're in. If the dragon is in a too low of a venue, they're not going to get any victory chain experience because they're too strong for that venue. It doesn't take that far off for it to be, like, for it to not exist. This is a level 24 venue, and Mary's level 25, which means she's not going to get any extra experience. However, if we were battling in the Kelp Beds or in the Golem Workshop, then she would be. However, she cannot deal with those higher venues on her own. Here's an example of 3 enemies that are able to dish out a lot of damage to Mary. Now, Mary only has 348 health. Each one of these guys can deal over 200 damage. If 2 of them hit her, she would not be able to survive. She would faint. I have a couple of alternatives. I can either use 2 potions, a health potion, which increases health by 250, or a minor health potion, which increases it by 100, or I can use sap. Sap takes away from the breath that she has by 15 points each time, and it only deals 100 points, well, approximately 100 points of health every time I use it. That's the equivalent of using 2 minor health potions, but also dealing about 400 to 500 points of damage each time. Which one do I want to do? Personally, I would use the health potions. The reason for this is I want to preserve her breath. Not dealing damage during that turn doesn't do me too much harm.
as long as they don't all attack her. Now, this was a bit of a waste of health potions, because she does not have enough health to deal with this. But that was just an example. Personally, if she has less than half health and she comes across three attackers, and she's not prepared to deal with them, especially since these are poisonous Torridae, which cannot, for some weird reason, cannot be one-shotted by a rallied eliminate, I would refresh the Coliseum. Refreshing the Coliseum helps you to restart the battle without losing any energy. Every time your dragons faint in the Coliseum or lose a battle, they lose energy here. These guys right here have energy lost. That's because I battled with them earlier, but the dragons that I had with them weren't strong enough for wherever they were, and they all lost. They lost 5 points because they lost a battle. Now, I'm going a lot slower than I normally would because I'm trying to walk you guys through this. However, I would have already had these two at level 6 if I wasn't going this slow, because I tend to click quite quickly. Now, as you can see, I scratched him, the common potted, scratched it. Not sure if it's male or female. It's quite fluffy on the chest, they never knows that. Fluffy potteds. Because I did not rally at first, I had to scratch, and now I'm going to eliminate. Salve, comma, Itachis are actually quite formidable. Even though they meditate, despite the fact that they are wind element, Salve, comma, Itachis use contuse. If Mary is contused, she is dealing 25% less damage for every attack. I mentioned this before when I spoke about contuse. Now, Mary has less strength than other dragons, remember? She can't afford to be contused. So, I always rally at first, and then I use eliminate. And I try to take them out as quickly as possible. Now, I defeated them all before they could contuse her, but if they were to contuse her, I would have to scratch an extra 2 times before I could eliminate them. The reason for this is her rallied eliminate is only slightly higher than a regular glass cannon's eliminate. Being contused, it reduces that eliminate down to less than that of a regular glass cannon's eliminate. So, despite the fact that she would be rallied, it still ends up being less. So, Salve, Itachis, you should always try to take them out as quickly as possible, and despite the fact that they are meditating enemies, don't start out with a team of 3 Salve, comma, Itachis in the mire. Now, this is a Wartoad. Wartoads are physical attackers, and Mary cannot handle one. I'm going to show you guys, however, what happens when you have a single leveler going up against a boss. You should only level with single levelers if you don't plan on hunting for bosses. If you plan on hunting for bosses, you should use 2 levelers, because bosses deal a lot of damage, whereas having 2 levelers would deal twice as much damage to that boss. As you can see, she's not going to survive this. Mary and the 2 fodder dragons just lost 5 energy. Let's see, she is right here. Remember how they had 5 energy less before? Now they have 10. Scythe Kama Itachis are very powerful mobs. They're a lot stronger than most others in the mire, and you should not start out with a team of 3 of them. They all take out 200 plus points of health with each blow that they do. 3 of them is 600. That's half of Mary's health. She cannot deal with a team of 3 of them at once without an eliminate. So, I usually press F5 to refresh the Coliseum and start over. Mossy Surday are perfectly fine to start out with in the mire. You basically just scratch them, and before the match is over, you'll have enough for an eliminate. I recommend saving it, however, for the next battle, so just scratch them until you're done. As you can see, some plague attacks can cause virus. If I were to use Sap while she has virus on her, she would actually lose health. Sap deals healing while also dealing damage to the opponent. Well, it gives healing points to Mary, health points to Mary, while also dealing damage to the opponent, like I mentioned before. While having virus cast on her, Mary would actually lose health every time she used Sap. Alright, so I just used Rally on her. Now, Brilliant Psyworms have a little bit more health than everybody else. I altered Mary's stats before, so I'm not entirely sure if she can one-shot these, but let's definitely try. Nope. And she didn't survive, so let's refresh this. No. Brilliant Psyworms have to be scratch eliminated even if your Mire Flyer has a rallied eliminate. That was just confirmed. Alrighty, so this video's been going on long enough. I'm gonna finish leveling these guys on my own. But I want to thank you guys for coming along with me and watching this video. I hope it gave you some basics on the Coliseum, as well as a little bit on some builds. Defender is a glass cannon. I don't know how to pronounce that, but he is also a glass cannon, but he is a variation. And Coral is she is the Ghostbuster, like we mentioned before. There are so many other builds, and I will link the master list of different builds below this video in the description, and also in the Flight Rising post that I'm going to be showing you guys in order to show you guys this video. So I hope you guys enjoyed it. I'm so sorry that it's so long. I didn't expect it to run on this long at all, but I hope it helped you guys a bit. For those of you who don't really know how to level, or didn't know that much about battle stones or anything like that, if you have any questions, please let me know. You can message me on Flight Rising. I am EeveeDream, as you can see there. And I'm going to be making other videos on the Coliseum. I'm going to be making some on leveling your dragons from scratch. I'm already working on a team with this guy here and a few others. So when I finish getting some step-by-step things on that, I'm going to post up that video. It's probably going to be very long, and it may take me a couple of weeks to do it, only because leveling dragons takes so long, and it's quite expensive. But I'm definitely going to be working on that. Before I do an actual step-by-step guide in video form, I'm actually going to explain some other popular guides so that you guys can get a breakdown on what they're saying. Of course, I'll be doing that with the guide maker's permissions, because it's their guides, and I don't want to go making videos on other people's guides like that. So yeah, once again, thank you. I already thanked you guys like at least a billion times for watching, and I hope it helped a bit. Just give me any questions. I'll see if I can make a short video explaining some things a little bit more in detail. This is mostly an introductory video. But thank you very much for watching, and I'll talk to you guys later. Bye.